This is The Allusionist, in which I, Helen Zaltzman, see some language, pick it up. All day long, I have good luck. This episode is another installment in the Telling Other Stories series about renaming. It's an adjunct to the last episode, Actively Passive, wherein Kennedy Whiters of unredactthefacts.com talked about the word plantation. This episode, we find out what happens when you do try to get rid of the word plantation from your street name. The episode contains references to the enslavement of black people and a brief description of the Canadian residential school system. On with the show. Last episode, I fleetingly mentioned a petition started in 2019 by the then 9-year-old Lila Wheeler in London, Ontario. It received 4,613 signatures, and it says, I have been trying to have the name of my street, Plantation Road, changed for the past year. The name of my street means a place where black slaves were forced to work in horrible conditions and were often whipped and punished and sometimes killed. With everything happening in our world right now, slave language needs to be abolished. Please sign the petition and help end racist language.
My name is Lila Daly Wheeler, and I live on Plantation Road in London, Ontario.
My name is Kristen Daly. I live on Plantation Road with my daughter, Lila. This is a great letter from one of our neighbors.
Hi, Lila. On June 30th, 2019, I will have lived in my home for 60 years. I have always liked the name of my street. You say that plantation means a place for black people. I looked up plantation in my dictionary, and there was no such definition like you state. I am voting a definite no to your request. I am enclosing a copy of a letter that was sent to all the participants. To me, it was an age-appropriate activity. Wishing you well in future projects, I remain yours truly.
So this newspaper article was from, do you have it? From 1972, the one she sent about...
It's about flamingos in storybook gardens.
So storybook gardens, kind of like the zoo thing that we had here. And there was some kids from this neighborhood who raised some money, I don't know, to do something about the flamingos that had died. So this was an example of the more age-appropriate activity that Lila should be doing. That came to our house, so that was a fun letter. She was told that a lot. Find something more age-appropriate to do.
Find something that doesn't make me, an adult, feel uncomfortable.
Exactly.
So, Lila, what gave you the idea to start the petition?
When I was 8, I was reading a book about the Underground Railroad, and a lot of times I found the word plantation, and they kept mentioning the plantation as a place where black slaves worked. And one day I was coming home from school, and I noticed that, well, I already knew the street name, but I just really noticed it then. Like, why is it this? Why is it named this?
How do you answer that question?
Right? We would love to know.
I've heard from people where they're like, well, where I live, it's not the USA, so plantation means something different. However, the resonance it has is strong.
Yes.
It doesn't really matter where it is.
But I remember you came home and you were raging about it. You were really, she was really angry when you made that connection, and you were horrified.
Kristen, what did you think when Lila made this point?
Well, I was never thrilled with the name itself when we moved in. I thought, well, this is kind of gross, but we needed to move, and this was the house we could get. So I remember thinking, this is gross, but I tried to ignore it, which I think a lot of us do. And then when she said that to me, I was like, she is so right. I already knew she was right. But hearing it from my 8-year-old daughter and seeing the outrage, the absolute, you were so mad when you came home that day. And you were right. And so seeing that passion and that outrage from her, I was like, she's right. Why am I sitting here doing nothing? So I said to her, you know, I will support you any way that her dad and I both, we will support you any way that we can in doing this. So, she's a phenomenal writer. So she wrote it all by herself. I don't help you with writing. No.
So I wrote a letter to our counselor, Steve Lehman.
When was this?
This was in 2000. It would have been 19. Here it is.
She saves everything.
So, dear Steve Lehman, my name is Lila. I'm 8 years old. This letter is important because I love the Caribbean. I don't think Black people would like the name Plantation. I have a friend who is Black and I want to respect her. Can you please change the name of our street? Because Plantation means a place where Black slaves and we love Black people in our home. Thank you.
So at 8 years old.
Eight years old.
What did Steve say?
Steve did write you back.
He basically said that it would cost a lot of money and it would take about 10 months and that all the neighbors would have to chip in.
And they would all have to agree.
Do you think that's true?
Well, we now know that's not true. So for a little while, she was kind of like, okay, well, what am I going to do? What's my next step here? The counselor's saying we need all this money.
How much money did they give you a number?
I think it was $10,000.
Okay. To replace the sign and tweak some maps.
Yeah, they have to give everyone on the street $100 for the inconvenience of changing their license.
All right.
I know. Just go online.
doesn't take that much to change your street name.
Does not. Really does not. What was the next thing you did? Oh, you sent letters to the neighbors.
Yes, I sent letters to the neighbors.
Yes, which was met with... We had some support from some of our wonderful neighbors, but other abusive emails, because we set up an email account.
Oh.
So some abusive emails with swearing. And she said in the letter, you know, I'm 8 and this is why I want to do it. And so there was a few abusive emails.
It's interesting that people feel so comfortable being abusive to an 8-year-old.
Shocking. Just shocking. And that wasn't even the worst of it. That was just the people on our street.
Yeah. How big's this street?
Oh, there's maybe 40 houses on it.
Yeah, but there's a school on it too.
And the school she goes to is on this street. So that's another, we kind of wonder why the school board isn't. They're renaming some schools here in our town, like Ryerson Public Schools being renamed, but they haven't said anything about the street that that school is on.
Okay, so renaming's happening.
Yes.
The eponymous Ryerson, Egerton Ryerson, had, and still has, his name on several educational establishments, parks, streets and a township to commemorate his advocation of free public schooling in Canada and libraries in every school. But his name is now being removed from some of those eponymous things. For example, in April 2022, Ryerson University in Toronto renamed itself Toronto Metropolitan University. Because Egerton Ryerson was also one of the designers of the residential school system, through which, for more than 100 years, Indigenous Canadian children were removed from their families and their culture and forced to assimilate into the Christian European-derived culture. Violence and psychological and sexual abuse by the staff were common, disease and malnutrition were rife, and many thousands of children are known to have died at the schools. It was the discovery in 2021 of the remains of 200 Indigenous children at the site of a former residential school in Kamloops, British Columbia, that spurred the school board for the southwestern Ontario region across the country to begin a review of names, under which, in 2022, Ryerson Elementary School in London, Ontario, was renamed Old North. That school is just 5 miles away from Lila and Kristen. So renaming is happening in their own city.
After that, things kind of, you were kind of...
Just staying.
Waiting, seeing what else could happen. Then
yeah.
And then what happened that got you to start the petition?
George Floyd was killed.
And you did have another city councillor come and work with you who wasn't our councillor.
Elizabeth Pelosa.
Elizabeth Pelosa. She was on the Civic Works Committee. And she said, even though I'm not the councillor here... She wanted to do something.
Oh.
So she kind of took the lead on this. And she came and met with you. And then she took it to council. So the cool thing, it's still in council.
Oh, wow.
Well, it's being reviewed. But that's because, do you remember why? That's why it's taking so long?
I don't.
You don't remember?
No, I don't.
Because they're trying to change.
Oh, you have to change the policy.
Yeah.
Oh.
So she's trying to change the policy about naming streets.
What's the policy about naming streets?
I'm not, like, right now it's just kind of whatever the developer picks. And so this has kind of spurred on this whole policy change. So it was voted through in council. Remember watching the city council meetings?
I do.
Yeah.
Sounds very age appropriate to have to watch council meetings and things.
Totally right.
Wonderful way to spend your youth.
It did have a lot of support.
It did.
In council, there was only one councillor who voted against it, who is no longer a councillor. Councillor Pelosa was pretty sure that it would be changed, but she did warn us that it would take a while because it's a policy change. And policy change takes long time. Long time. And so I believe right now it's being doing a report on it. I think that the report was due back to council in early 2024.
Okay. 4 years for policy change, you think? What if a policy was really urgent stuff, like life and death stuff?
Yes. Maybe they need to review the policy. Review it.
Yes, maybe they need to.
That would be another 4 years, though.
They'll get round to that in, like, 2049.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Maybe they're like, if I wait long enough, climate change will take care of it all.
Totally.
Just sit it out. Be strong.
Just wait. We'll just wait.
Just wait.
Just gotta keep at it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why you start early. Gives you more time to keep at it.
Yeah.
Exactly. Start at 8. First decade of your life, you're already
Do you think they're just waiting? They think if they wait long enough without doing anything, Lila will have forgotten and got into something else.
Probably.
You think so?
I think that they've just kind of, they know about it, but they've just waited so that I would forget about it.
Are you going to forget about it?
No.
Good luck. She's so stubborn in a good way that it will not be forgotten. No.
What gave you the idea to start a petition specifically? Had you petitioned before?
I didn't, but I remember that I seen lots of petitions about Black Lives Matter after George Floyd was killed. And I remember seeing a lot about changing street names and other names of public schools.
You had some great support for your petition as well.
Yeah.
We had a local artist from Ghana, KFT. He's a rapper. He's amazing. And he did this whole, it's in the paper, supporting Lila and saying how much this meant to his family, that she was standing up and saying this. And your friend Jelena, her mom, what did she say?
It means so much to us and it's very close to our hearts.
Yeah, they're Jamaican, Lila's Jamaican friends, and Jelena's mom is so, so proud of you.
Yeah, well, of course, Jamaica got plantations up the wazoo.
Yes, yeah.
Which people will happily forget.
Lila won't, though.
I won't.
She never forgets it.
At what point did it reach people beyond the people that live on the street and go to the school? Was that the petition?
I think that it was mostly the newspaper, because we used to have a photographer for the London Free Press that lived on our street, and he asked if he could take pictures to write about it in the paper. So I think that's when it really reached the world outside of the street.
Did it change the kinds of responses you get when more people know about it?
Yes. We got some very hateful responses.
More hateful.
Yes.
Because we had some really great support on our street, too. Some really wonderful support. A couple hateful responses from our street, but only two. But then when it went into the paper, the hate, no, it was everywhere. It was shocking. We got phone calls because our number, we still have a dinosaur phone, like a landline. So, and it's listed. And so they would look it up because they knew her last name and her street. And they would call us. And I mean, I had people telling me that they were calling the police because what I am making her do is child abuse. There was one that really annoyed you when people would say
that you were making me do it.
People would say, oh, you put your kid up to this. And I'd be like, well, do you want to come and talk to her? Because I didn't, like, if you knew her. But that was a lot. And so we were abusing her. And, you know, you should be playing with makeup.
Why? That was one?
Yes.
Sure. And then they would be like, she's too young.
Right. Yeah. So it was a lot of ageism, I found.
Yeah.
The email address was not a good idea. That was terrible. And, you know, Facebook commenters and stuff. And they're just horrific. The swearing, the language that they would use against, you were 9 at the time.
Yes.
It was disgusting. Very upsetting. I wouldn't engage, but I still read the stuff. Lila at that time, she didn't know because she was only 9.
Yeah.
I shielded her from a lot of that stuff when it first came out because it was intense. And it was just so much hate. But we did have some really good support.
We did.
There was a lot of people who supported you. Adam Pauly, the actor, he signed the petition and put it on his Twitter. Yeah. Huh. Dr. J, he's a Caribbean DJ, a soca DJ in Toronto. He was a huge supporter when he found out about this. And he had it all over his Instagram and had the whole community behind her. So there was some really amazing support as well. Lots of people signed the petition quietly and were like, awesome, good job, and continued on with their lives. But the people, you know, it's always the people who complain that are the loudest.
And they don't even live on the street.
No. Oh, no.
Why do you think they're so bothered about it?
It's ridiculous how many people were and how inconvenient it would be. That was the other. Oh, what an inconvenience. Is this what we're doing with taxpayer money? What an inconvenience. That was the other complaint. I'm thinking, okay.
Yeah, one of the comments on the London Free Press article about Lila from June 2020 was, I quote, "It would mix up all the maps and GPS. The slaves were bought from violent slave traders and given better lives." Well, yeah, sure, plantation owners' motives were notoriously altruistic. Also, those are two very different takes for a single sentence. Another comment says, "If she really wanted to help the world, especially for females aged 13 to 30, start a petition to abolish the words like and oh my god from that demographic's lexicon." I'd vote to abolish the use of females as a noun, unless you're narrating a documentary about how insects reproduce.
There was also a lot of comments like, well, plantation can mean other things too.
Well, it can mean other things, but it also means...
Exactly.
There can be more than one meaning for a word.
Mm-hmm. And there is lots in English, right?
Oh, yeah. Some of them really ruin it for the rest of the meanings.
Absolutely. This is one of them.
Are there people who are like, well, you're white, you shouldn't be saying these things on behalf of black people, what they should be upset by?
People do. We'd have a lot of. And it was, to be honest, it was always white men who were saying that. It was never anyone from the black community. They were always so supportive and so... That was actually one of the reasons that Kwasi, the musician, KFT, he did a whole interview saying this is amazing. And look, I'm standing here supporting Lila. The local Black Lives Matter chapter was very supportive of Lila as well. So we had a lot of good support. That's what I always try to focus on.
Yeah, not the bad support.
It was hard as a mom to this wonderful human to see and hear the things that were written about her. It was hard, but I just focused on the people who mattered. That's why you would tell Lila, you know, whose opinion matters to you? Like,
yeah.
Jelena and her mom, that opinion matters
really
to you.
I don't really care about the 50-year-old neighbors.
You don't care. That's right. You don't care about their opinion, so don't let it bother you, right? The people who you respect, that's whose opinion matters. And you've never let it deter you either, which I have always found remarkable, because I think of me at your age and I would have been like, I'm not doing this anymore.
Yeah.
It never deterred you.
Nope.
You were like, well, it's wrong, so I'm going to keep doing it.
I really feel like I wasted my childhood.
Right?
It does seem to be quite a common pattern that people are a lot happier to tolerate racism than they are if you point it out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why do you think that is?
Because they don't want to deal with it because they feel either guilty or they just don't want to deal with it.
Yeah,
they just want to let it sit quietly and it can come up some other time, but they don't want to deal with it.
Well, this doesn't affect me, so why would I?
Why would I care?
Because I'm not going to do something to inconvenience myself, like going online and changing my license. So,
oh, that would just be terrible.
Oh, so hard.
How do you feel when you have to tell someone your address?
I feel uncomfortable. I'm like, why am I writing this? Why am I talking about this?
I feel the same way. I'm mortified. I was just, you know, seeing my surgeon for my follow-up and they were like, you're on Plantation Road? I was like, yes, I am. Okay, the person reading it was horrified that that was the name of my street. And sometimes your dad calls it Racism Road.
Yes.
Do you think some of the locals would be comfortable with you renaming it that? They're like, all right, that aligns right? with my values.
Yeah, totally. So what do we refer to it as when we're talking to each other?
Josiah Henson Way.
Josiah Henson Way, because that's what we hope that it would be. That was one of your suggestions for renaming it was Josiah Henson Way.
Tell us about Josiah Henson. How did you land on him as a plan?
Well, I remember you were reading a book called The Life of Josiah Henson, and I remember you telling me about him, and I thought, well, this might be a good name, a good new name for the street.
Josiah Henson was enslaved in the USA, and he escaped to Canada, and then he set up a community actually not too far from us. It was about 2 hours, were we?
Yeah.
Because we went to see the community that he set up for other slaves who had escaped. There was a chapel, and he taught like woodworking and taught escaped slaves all of these amazing skills. So he was like a little safe house here in Canada. So that was why you kind of decided on that one.
Yeah.
To honor someone instead of what we have now.
What other names did you think up?
Well, originally I had... There we go. Daisy Drive, Orchid Road, Wildberry Road, Bluebell Drive, and Wild Cherry Road.
So there's a lot of flower and tree names around us. One of the
there's
streets.
There's hibiscus, palm tree.
So she thought maybe that would be anything other than... But people will say, oh, well, it's a plantation because that's where trees are planted and the other streets are named after trees in your neighborhood. Well, who do you think planted the trees?
Lila, how do you feel when you think... Gosh, I started this thing when I was 9, and that was 2019, and the street is still called the same thing.
It's very shocking when I really think about it. I was 9, now I'm almost 13, and it's just shocking to see that it hasn't gone anywhere.
How are other renaming campaigns going in your city? Like, are there other streets? You mentioned Ryerson...
Ryerson School has been changed already because it was the school board who gets to make that decision. So they changed that. There is another renaming campaign who did a petition. Do you remember the name of the street? It's in our neighborhood. It's Indian Road.
Great.
Enough. Just another. It's delightful. It's about 10 minutes from us. And so they had also started a petition that also would be part of the policy change. That's the only other one I know about specifically. Do you know any others?
I know that the statue was taken down in Toronto,
mm-hmm.
and I know that they've changed some street names in Toronto, but other than that, in London, I'm not sure.
Yeah, in London, we don't have a lot of traction here. I know Dundas Street is being changed in Toronto as well.
And that's a huge, long street.
Humongous.
That's a lot of signage to switch.
I think how many signs do we have on ours? Four.
Yeah.
There'd be four signs that needed to be changed.
You could print those out and laminate them and put them up.
Right. Just put them up, yeah. That was a thought. Actually, one of my friends who was very supportive said, oh, that's it. One night, we're just going to go rip them all down. And do you remember what your response to that was?
That's not what Martin Luther King Jr. would do.
That was her response.
He'd go and sit and wait for the council to change the policy.
It's like, how do you argue with your 10-year-old who says that to you? But you're right. You're right. That's not the way to go about it. It takes time because you're changing policy.
Yeah.
And policy is like, I'm tired. Why are you waking me up?
Right.
I think that it should be going somewhere.
It is. Slowly.
Change is slow.
And lots of people don't like change.
Why do you think that is?
Yeah, why do you think that is?
Well, they've been stuck in their ways for so long that it's just they don't like change. They don't like things to be different. They want everything to be the way it was whenever they were my age.
Well, otherwise it might imply that things were bad and could have been better.
And they don't want their childhood ruined by that.
Of course, you can ruin someone's childhood decades later.
Right, of course. Yes, by renaming a street, right? Oh, yeah, people have lots of strong opinions on this, but I'm proud of you for not stopping.
Hey there, pod fan of pod. One of my favourite podcasts of this decade has returned with a second season, FOGO, Fear of Going Outside, in which Ivy Lee, with one E, tries to train herself to be an outdoorsy person. Well, the giveaway that she's not a true outdoorsy person is that she's making a podcast, which is a very indoorsy activity. But she is a very funny person, and this season she is learning to hunt. And what's scarier, the huge creepy crawlies of Texas or the gun enthusiasts? Listen to Fear of Going Outside at fogopodcast.com. Want to support this show, your old friend the Allusionist? Tell someone about it. It really helps when you recommend the show to people. And if you have some cash to spare, or launder, then you can hurl it my way at theallusionist.org/donate, and in return, you get behind-the-scenes glimpses of each episode, fortnightly live streams, including soothing readings from dictionaries, plus so much more, TV watch-alongs, at the moment we're watching Great Pottery Throwdown, the quarterfinals impend, and best of all, you get to be in the Allusionverse Discord community. Join us at theallusionist.org/donate. Your randomly selected word from the dictionary today is Zonder, noun, a hot, dusty north wind in Argentina. Try using Zonder in an email today. This episode was produced by me, Helen Zaltzman, thanks to Dan Engler for coming up with the title of the episode. Martin Austwick of palebirdmusic.com provided the original music and editorial assistance. Our ad partner is Multitude. If you want to hear me speak lovingly about your product, you can sponsor an episode of The Allusionist. Contact Multitude at multitude.productions/ads. Find Allusionist Show on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube and Twitter. And you can hear or read every episode, get links to more information about the topics they're in, and see the full dictionary entries for the randomly selected words, and tell me about your renaming projects at the show's forever home, theallusionist.org.